MTC 21 Unit 8 12 Exercise 1. Given that the internet has become integrated in everyday lives and the communication of social support is an important part of interpersonal interaction, it is not surprising that much support is provided and received online. People can get in touch with others who are facing the same or a similar situation and can exchange informational or emotional support as they would like to do in an offline situation. Even though relationships are acquired in a different manner, in time some of them can become just as broad and deep as relationships that are formed offline. Nevertheless, interacting via the internet has a number of characteristics that make it fundamentally different from face-to-face communication. The features of computer-mediated communication can affect how people compose messages, how they acquire and maintain relationships, and how groups are organized and structured. Online support groups may therefore offer some unique characteristics compared to offline groups in that they allow anonymous participation, are text-based, and facilitate place and time-independent interactions that offer possibilities to expand social networks. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 21, Unit 8. 12 Exercise 2. The variety of ways in which students in music class can now interact with sound offers greater opportunities to individualize instruction. The wide variety of software environments now available allows teachers to tailor assignments and levels of support to meet particular students' needs. By varying projects according to student readiness, learning style, and interest, music teachers can differentiate their instruction, a task that can be challenging in many traditional music instruction formats. For example, the use of headphones allows students to work simultaneously on different projects without sonically interfering with other music activities in the classroom. The use of this simple piece of technology significantly expands the teacher's ability to facilitate multiple group or individual projects in the same classroom space. A student and the teacher are working together, another student is intent at the piano, and a third student is playing acoustic guitar without interference by the use of headphones or earbuds. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 21, Unit 8. 12 Exercise 3. Colleges use price discrimination. In 1995, for example, Johns Hopkins University began offering aid according to the students' price elasticity of demand for attending the university. 1995 Johns Hopkins. Johns Hopkins wanted to attract academically gifted students who would major in humanities but might attend other universities. Johns Hopkins. These students had relatively elastic demand curves for education at Johns Hopkins, given the availability of substitute universities. Johns Hopkins. By granting them an extra $3,000 in aid, the university was able to increase enrollment in that group by 20%. 20%. However, Johns Hopkins did not worry about losing prospective pre-med students, whose demand curves for education at Johns Hopkins were relatively inelastic. Johns Hopkins, Johns Hopkins. Because most of these students were already hooked on its pre-med program, a price increase would not knock many out. Johns Hopkins cut this group's aid by $1,000 per student and still increased net revenue. Johns Hopkins 1,000. Today, this pricing strategy is being tried out at colleges and universities all over the nation. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 21, Unit 8. 12 Exercise 4. In 1950, Alan Turing published his famous article Computing Machinery and Intelligence in the journal Mind. 1950 Alan Turing Mind Computing Machinery and Intelligence. This article is arguably the most influential and widely read article in the philosophy of artificial intelligence. Indeed, most of the debate in the philosophy of artificial intelligence over the last 50 years concerns issues that were raised and discussed by Turing. 50 Turing. Turing's genius was not only in developing the theory of computability but also in understanding the impact, both practical and philosophical, that computing machinery would have. Turing. Turing believed that computers, if properly designed and educated, could exhibit intelligent behavior, even behavior that would be indistinguishable from human intelligent behavior. Turing. His vision of the possibility of machine intelligence has been highly inspiring and extremely controversial. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 2-1, Unit 8. 1-2 Exercise 5-6. Like other medicinal products, vaccines are produced by the biopharmaceutical industry and have to meet the same standards of safety and efficacy as any other drug. All medicines carry some risk, which has to be balanced against the benefits provided. There are particular issues with vaccines, however, since most are designed to provide protection against future infections and are, therefore, administered to healthy people who have to take the risk of unwanted side effects due to immune system activation. This, along with the relatively low financial returns of vaccines, has discouraged the biopharmaceutical industry from working in this area of drug development. When I joined the industry in the 1980s, working in an immunology department, there was absolutely no interest in developing vaccines. 1980. Ironically, I had previously worked in a tumor immunology unit whose long-term aim was to discover how the body uses the immune system to fight cancer. Armed with this knowledge, it might then be possible to vaccinate against the disease. Indeed, a cancer vaccine has recently been introduced for the human papillomavirus, HPV, that causes cervical cancer and is helping to revive industry enthusiasm for vaccines in general. HPV. However, this vaccine is still based on the conventional principle of immunizing healthy individuals to prevent possible infection by the virus in the future. The point of the tumor immunology approach is that it should be possible to develop a therapeutic vaccine to treat the disease itself once it has become established. Attempts at producing true cancer vaccines along these lines have been made for many years now, and the work is slowly producing encouraging results. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 2-1, Unit 8. 1-2 Exercise 7. In the early 1800s, mathematician and physicist Joseph Fourier recognized that as the sun's energy or radiation passes through the atmosphere and strikes the Earth's surface, it heats up the planet. 1800 Joseph Fourier. Without the atmosphere, though, the planet would regularly turn frigid. Fourier was the first to recognize that the atmosphere insulates Earth from heat loss like a blanket. Fourier. Then in 1859, scientist John Tyndall discovered something astonishing about one of the trace gases in our atmosphere, carbon dioxide. 1859 John Tyndall. While the other major components of the atmosphere, nitrogen and oxygen, are essentially transparent to long-wave radiation, carbon dioxide is not. Carbon dioxide, along with water vapor, even in small quantities, absorbs long-wave energy, which is stored as heat. Several decades later, Swedish chemist Svante Arrhenius went further, suggesting that increased levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere could alter Earth's surface temperatures. Svante Arrhenius. Since that time, observations and experimental evidence have repeatedly confirmed these early discoveries. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 2-1, Unit 8. 1-2 Exercise 8. Historically in the United States, prevention hasn't been prioritized, and, furthermore, virtually no attention has been paid to fostering a systematic, quality prevention approach. For decades, the national prevention model relied primarily on educating people about health and safety risks, hoping they would magically change their behavior. As well-intended as educational efforts are, they can never be very effective without simultaneously changing home and community environments, social norms, policies, and institutions. Establishing a broader view beyond brochures, we might say, is critical. Research has shown it is unrealistic to expect that simply warning people about a danger will be sufficient to help them change their long-standing habits or avoid unhealthy exposures on their own. A quality prevention approach is one in which education is part of a well-designed, sustained, comprehensive effort to broadly improve community environments, social norms, institutional practices, and policies. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 2-1, Unit 8. 1-2, Exercise 9. Every year, Western countries export millions of tons of waste to China, particularly plastics and paper, for treatment and recycling. It is transported by freight in empty shipping containers used for exporting Chinese goods. As disposal and landfill prices are high in the West, sending waste overseas, such as to China, is a cheaper option. Another reason is to overcome strict environmental and waste regulations. In some cases, Chinese companies set up offices overseas to buy waste, and they have been able to offer higher prices and accept higher quantities of waste than their counterparts in the origin country. However, the global recycling trade is not without criticism. Complaints include the environmental and social costs of shipping waste, no guarantee over environmental and other standards in China, reduced business and materials for recyclers in the country of origin, and claims that the West is dumping its rubbish on China. It also highlights failures in the recycling market in the West. Recently, China's recycling industry was adversely affected by the global economic crisis, as reduced consumer demand for products led to lower prices of recyclables. Consequently, many Chinese recycling units closed. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 2-1, Unit 8. 1-2, Exercise 10. The wild flowers of spring are beloved by all who enjoy nature. The color they bring to the landscape after winter's long period of browns, grays, and white makes the heart sing and spirits rise, drawing wildflower lovers into the woods each spring to seek them out. However, by the time summer arrives, we seem to have become accustomed to nature's multi-hued palette, and sadly, the wildflowers of summer tend to get less of our attention. Yet the natural history of summer blooming flowers is every bit as interesting as that of spring wildflowers, and in some cases more so because of the greater diversity of insects present during the summer months. The interrelationships between flowers, the insects that visit them, the predators and parasites of those insects, and the animals that disperse their seeds can be even more complex than those involving spring wildflowers. MTC. Good job. Let's start. MTC. 2-1, Unit 8. 1-2, Exercise 11-12. Albedo is the fraction of incident solar radiation, sunlight, more or less, that gets reflected by the surface of some landscape element, like a tree or a parking lot or a rock or a snowbank. The remainder gets absorbed, warming up the surface. Rock and soil and forests typically have pretty low albedos, meaning they absorb a lot of the sun's heat, and snow and ice have high albedos. That's why you risk snow blindness if you don't wear sunglasses while traversing a glacier or skiing on your local hill. Even if it's not an especially sunny day, your eyes receive not only the sunlight from above, but also the reflected sunlight from below. And that reflected energy is energy that doesn't go toward warming up and melting the ice or snow. In a landscape widely covered by glaciers, the overall albedo is generally high. But say we have a long-term rise in temperature. It might be the result of natural climate changes like the variations in Earth's orbit that drove the ice ages, for instance, or a human-induced increase in greenhouse gas concentrations, caused by fossil fuel combustion and deforestation associated with population growth and economic expansion. Over time, glaciers start melting away under higher temperatures, the proportion of the landscape covered by ice and snow decreases, and that covered by rock and soil and advancing vegetation increases. Consequently, the albedo of the landscape as a whole goes down. So, a greater proportion of the incident sunlight goes to warming the surface of the landscape, rather than just being reflected back up. This accelerates the melting and recession of ice sheets, and that in turn further accelerates the reduction in overall albedo, and so on. MTC. Good job.